come on.
The deadlift is a powerlifting movement. It involves lifting a barbell vertically off the ground. The movement is complete once the body is locked out in an upright position.
The deadlift is a discrete skill, as there is a definitive start and end to the movement. It is defined as a gross movement, as it recruits a large number of muscle groups and as it does not involve precise movements or hand-eye coordination. The deadlift is a closed motor skill, as the environment and object are not subject to change.
In reference to Gentile's two-dimensional taxonomy, the deadlift is classified as 1B. This is due to the stationary environment, the absence of intertrial variability, and the body stable with object manipulation.
The setup phase. When first preparing for the deadlift, there are a few key aspects to consider. These include grip and feet positioning. The grips for a deadlift include overhand and alternating. For a conventional deadlift, the feet should be spread at a comfortable position, approximately shoulder width apart. For a sumo deadlift, a much wider stance should be employed. The initial pull phase. Through the pull phase of the lift, it is important that a neutral spine is adopted throughout the movement. Upon reaching the lockout phase, the athlete is required to end the lift in an upright position by thrusting the hips forward and tightening the core, as demonstrated in the clip.
Each three stages of learning consists of the cognitive stage, the associative stage, and the autonomous stage. The cognitive stage is the first stage of learning. This is where the learner tries to understand how to perform the movement skill through observation, verbal instruction, and through the learner's own sensory feedback. At this stage of learning the deadlift, it is important that minimal weight, if any, should be lifted to prevent injury. The second stage is the associative stage. This is where the learner begins to gain a bit of competency about the skill. Everything now makes sense and the learner is able to adjust the movement pattern as the situation demands. At this stage of the deadlift, the learner is able to lift an appropriate load through measured weight, reps, and sets. The third and final stage is the autonomous stage. By this stage, the skill has become quite natural. The learner has improved a lot and minimal errors are apparent. At this stage of the deadlift, some innovation can take place to make the deadlift more difficult, to activate different muscle groups, and to excite different ranges of motion. Some examples of these are Romanian deadlifts, one-legged deadlifts, sumo deadlifts, and deficit deadlifts.
Some common errors and examples of bad form of the deadlift include having a rounded back throughout the movement. This can put a dangerous amount of stress on the spine that can lead to injuries. To ensure this doesn't happen, it is important to employ verbal cues throughout the movement. Another example of bad form is hyperextension at lockout. This can be fixed by maintaining a natural and a firm arch in the lower back.
Verbal cues are used in a variety of ways when teaching new skills. They are used to draw attention to necessary information and to help the learner focus on key elements of the skill. Verbal cues should be given to beginners while demonstrating the new skills to them, as well as to the learners while they're in practice, to prompt technique correction. When learning the deadlift, verbal cues such as look, feel, and touch are necessary in correcting the learner's posture and technique. Common cues for the deadlift also include chest out, heels through the floor, back straight, and eyes forward.
Throughout the cognitive and associative stages of learning, a balance of feedback appropriate to the learner's progression and performance should be applied. This is done in order to avoid overloading the learner with feedback as not to hinder performance. Using augmented feedback, you are able to convey the knowledge of performance. This allows the learner to understand the actual movement pattern and the actions and characteristics endured to lead to their results. This type of feedback is concurrent as it is applied throughout the learner's training and exercise. It is also used post-session in order to summarise the task performed, which can be identified as terminal feedback.
Motivation is the underlying factor which determines how much someone wants to achieve their goal, and it comes in two forms. These are intrinsic motivation, which is motivation coming from within the learner to better themselves for themselves, and extrinsic motivation,
which is motivation coming from an external source, want to do well to get recognised by others. Goal setting is an effective technique for motivating learners as they strive to reach their deadlifting goals. This can be both intrinsic and extrinsic motivation. Things such as a time frame to hit a certain amount of reps of a specified weight, or the improvement of technique may be goals used in deadlifting to motivate learners. Pre-tests, being before the program, and post-tests, being after the program, go hand in hand in evaluating a person's improvement over a given time period. These tests must be in the same conditions to ensure that there is reliability within them. In deadlifting terms, this can be used to measure the quality, being the technique of the skill, and quantity, being the number of reps or the amount of weight executed in the skill. Retention tests are like comprehension tests, to go back and see if the skill has really been learned and permanently understood. Transfer tests involve the skill present under a different condition to that originally measured. A transfer test determines the adaptability of performance changes. Two apparent situation changes can be a new context in which the skill is performed. In deadlifting terms, it may be at a powerlifting meet compared to just at the gym. And also a variation of the skill itself, a deficit deadlift as opposed to a regular deadlift, for example. For example, the test prescribed to the athlete was a 5-rep attempt at the deadlift. The quantitative measures were taken by how many correct form reps amongst the 5 were recorded. The qualitative measure is included in the test regarding the form of the counted reps. This pre-test was rated 1 out of 5. An appropriate training program can look like this. Week 1, hip hinge movement and some good mornings. Week 2 can consist of some lightly weighted good mornings and some rack pulls. Week 3 can consist of some Romanian deadlifts and some deadlifts off blocks. Week 4 can contain some deadlifts off the floor and some deficit deadlifts. Let's have a look at this 4-week training program in more detail. The hip hinge movement is a simplified segment of the lockout phase of the deadlift, as are the good mornings, which are slightly more advanced but still continue to reassure the cues of neutral spine, eyes forward, glutes thrusting forward and chest out. Continuing the program with good mornings but adding weight allows the learner to feel comfortable with the addition and external force on the movement. The rack pulls further continue the skill as they require the body to vertically pull the weight as though they would in a deadlift. Some things to supervise in this week's exercises are neutral spine again, tight core, upright body position and hip flexion. Moving on to week 3, the athlete is slowly increasing their workload. They will begin Romanian deadlifts. This exercise follows on from previous rack pulls by requiring a stability aspect. This is where the participant is required to keep all parts of the body working together in order to correctly harness the barbell both up and down the body. The athlete will then begin to attempt a deadlift off raised blocks. This assists the participant with the initial full phase of the lift. Key things to look for on this week include, again, initial spine, shin stay straight as possible, weight on heels, barbell travels vertically up the body. By now, the participant is ready to take on the full extent of the exercise and can begin practice deadlift from the floor. It is important that the athlete is taken into account all the past cues and techniques learned in order to progress successfully into the lift. Assuming the athlete has executed it well, he or she can move on to a more advanced maneuver, that being the deficit deadlift. Even at this stage, it is important to observe the following: neutral spine, glute activation, weight on heels, straight shins. This post-program test was rated a 5 out of 5.